Well, Gene had his work cut out for him this morning with the scripture reading, didn't he? 19 verses, and but he did his homework. You know, he looked up online how to pronounce one of those names in the beginning. I didn't do that in Monroe Chapel. I stumbled through that name. But he did a good job, and that was a long one, but the reason why it's long is because I wanted to capture Daniel's prayer. Prayer is a difficult thing, and yet at the same time, prayer is the easy thing, isn't it? Prayer is simple in one way, in that we talk to God. There's nothing that abstract about it. We just talk to God like we talk to anyone else. We don't have to say any magic words. We don't have to use any church words. We can speak regularly. We can speak in many different ways. As I said during children's time last week, prayer is portable. We can take it anywhere that we want because we can pray out loud or we can pray in our head. We can pray folding our hands with our hands up or while we can multitask. We can pray while we're mowing the lawn or we can pray while driving to work. We can pray anytime and anywhere. It's really simple and it helps connect us to God, helps us grow in our faith. But yet, prayer can also be complicated in another way, can't it? Because, okay, we can pray to God about anything, so narrow it down, right? What should I pray for? How do I know what to say? How do I know where to start? How do I know what's a selfish prayer and what's not a selfish prayer? I don't want to be selfish. And then if you're like me, sometimes what happens is that you end up praying for the same thing every day, which is good, right? We're told that we should pray continually. But, you know, you pray for yourself, you pray for others on your list, but your prayer ends up being the same thing every day, and so it starts to become like a broken record. You know, has that ever happened to you? And then you start to think, well, what's the point of this? You know, does God really need to hear this over and over again, or is he getting tired of me saying the same thing over again? What is the deal? And so pretty soon you start to think that, well, this prayer is kind of silly. You know, it's kind of useless. And so you may even be tempted to give it up. But Daniel shows us a good model for prayer that we can follow. Not necessarily every day, but on certain occasions. It's a different way to pray. It's kind of unusual. It's not how we're usually comfortable praying. But some of the elements we can take into our daily prayer, and then some of it we might do on an occasion. So we're in Daniel 9 right now, a few chapters past where we were last week, and King Darius is still ruling the area where Daniel lives. And Daniel's reading from the prophet Jeremiah. Now, Jeremiah is a book of the Bible in the Old Testament. And the same words that he was reading back then, the words of the prophet said that the people would be living in this foreign land for about 70 years. And then they would return. So Daniel reads this, and he's lived through this time period. And he knows that time is up. And so he starts to pray to God, and he starts by confessing the sins of everyone. Not just him. This is a collective prayer. It's not individual. He's praying for everyone. And so he identifies himself as Israel, meaning all of the people. And so he says, we have sinned before you. And then he not only confesses the sin, he goes into detail talking about how they've sinned. They haven't followed God's commands. They haven't kept their end of the covenant. They should have known better. It said in the law of Moses, which usually when we think of the law of Moses, we think of the book of Deuteronomy. And in the law of Moses, it said the blessings and curses are laid out. If you follow your end of the covenant, that God would keep them secure in their land. But if they did not, and if they continued to rebel, then God would allow this thing to happen to them, where their land would be destroyed and they would be living in a foreign place. And yet, the prophet foretold that there was still hope. There's still hope. And so Daniel, knowing that this, he looks around him and he says, this is just not right. This is not the way the world should be. Jerusalem is a mess. We're not able to live there anymore. We're not able to be at the temple. There is no temple. We're not able to give sacrifices. This is not right. And so he prays to God, first of all, confessing their sins as a people, explaining what they are. Then he recalls God's mighty acts in the past. You know, how God has chosen them. Out of all the peoples of the world, God chose them. And starting in Egypt as slaves, he led them out of that and brought them to the promised land in an epic story. And he promised to be with them, and he forgave them over and over again as they sinned and rebelled and worshipped other gods. He continued to give them more chances and to try to reconcile them, and yet it wasn't working. They continued to rebel and go their own way and do whatever they want, until finally God let the Babylonians come and destroy the land. And Daniel sees, though, that time is up. And so he starts, this is the part of the prayer that's weird. This is the part of the prayer that we're not used to because he's pretty demanding. He doesn't really ask, he almost demands that God does what he says he's going to do. You know, and he's not, it's not like Daniel's being selfish, like he's saying, Lord, you have got to give me a new car. No. But he's saying, you have got to do what you said you're going to do. You know, he's appealing to God's character. He says, you know, he explains about God. You are a forgiving God. You are compassionate. You are loving. And this is just wonderful. Now, God, do you notice that your land that you brought us to is still desolate? Do you notice that we are still in this foreign place? And remember, God, we are your witnesses. This doesn't look good. And he's saying, remember, God, your character. Remember what you have promised. It's time to bring it about now. So you need to do something right now. And so he says, oh, Lord, listen. Oh, Lord, forgive. Oh, Lord, act. Do something. Because this is not right. Wow. That's something. And he's pretty passionate in his prayer. Oftentimes, our prayers are hurried, maybe because we need to get to work, or we need to whatever we need to do because we're busy people. But Daniel's very passionate in this prayer. Do we ever have an occasion to pray this way? Now, there are some elements, like I said, we can incorporate into prayer on a regular basis. So oftentimes, what happens is that I just pray for what I need, or you know, go through the list, whatever, and I start that way. But what is good to do is to first, before we ask anything, we confess our sin. So it puts us in our place and we realize, okay, we're not so great, you know, but God loves us anyway. Therefore, we are highly valued and loved. And so even though we sin, we are still lovable and forgivable. And so we know where we are in relation to God. And then we recall God's mighty acts of salvation. Maybe you can talk, you can thank God for who he is. You can thank him for what he's done in your life. You can look in the past and you can maybe share a thing or two about just remembering a time that God has worked on your behalf. And you can give thanks for that. And then that puts us in that spirit of humility to where we're ready to then present our requests to God. And this is what Daniel did. And of course, his request was really powerful. It was really demanding. And sometimes we have an occasion to pray that way too, I think. Because the world is not all as it should be, is it? Things are not, don't always look like the kingdom of God. Sometimes they do. Usually the things that are not on the news, those are the good things, right? Usually the good things, when we see the kingdom of God at work and we see people doing good things, a lot of times that's not on the news, right? There's too many negative things to put on the news, and let's face it, the negative things get the ratings. That's why we do that. But they have plenty of material to draw from, don't they? It seems like way too often people are getting run over by cars, right? On purpose. It seems like there's too much war going on, and threats of war, and talk of war. It seems like there are too many people who are fighting one another, not only around the world, but also within the United States. Different people groups, different races, all the tension that's in our society right now. It just seems like, in a lot of ways, we see the kingdom of God, but then in a lot of ways, we don't see the kingdom of God. As we know that the way the world is not the way God intends it to be. And so I think that we have occasion to pray this way. Because we can become discouraged too, right? I mean, even though we're Christians, even though we're hopeful, and even though we know that God is greater than everything, and that God will be victorious, still we can be discouraged. We can grow tired. Because we know that life and love will ultimately win and have the last word, but yet we're tired of waiting for it. When will it happen? When, Lord, will you act? Because the world is definitely not as it should be. I'd like you to be in just an attitude of prayer. We're going to pray a little bit. I want you to be in an attitude of prayer, but draw your attention as you do to the screen for a song that we're going to play that's going to just talk about the broken world, but yet, even though the world is broken, God can restore all things. At this time, I'm going to lead us in a prayer that's modeled after the Daniel prayer. And I'm going to share some words, and then in a little bit I'm going to prompt you. I'm going to share some of the things in our world that are broken. And then I am going to invite us all to say together after each thing, "Oh Lord, listen." And I'll prompt you when we're ready to do that. So let's pray. Lord, you are the great and awesome God. You keep your word and you're faithful to all who love you and obey your commands. But we've sinned and we've done wrong. Not just us, but our world. We've been wicked and rebelled. We've turned away from your commands and your laws. We've not listened to the words of Scripture nor your Holy Spirit in our hearts. But Lord, we know that you are righteous, you are loving, you are compassionate. And you've given your all when you gave your Son, Jesus Christ, to die on the cross for us. And yet here we are, the humanity of earth, acting foolish and straying further from your will, even as you strive to win our affection. Lord, we remember your mighty acts of salvation. We've read about how you freed your people, the Hebrews, from slavery in Egypt and led them to the Promised Land. We read about how you sent them into exile for their unfaithfulness. But when Daniel cried out to you, you listened to his prayer and brought them back to the Holy Land. We also read about how when all seemed lost, you sent your Son Jesus Christ to die for us. And you gave birth to the church. And you asked us to be a part of the church, bringing hope and renewal to a broken world. We have seen you at work in history, and we also know that you have been at work in our own lives, where we have seen your guiding light in our past. And so, Lord, we know that we have sinned, but we also know that you are forgiving and merciful. We know our world is, in many ways, in sad shape, but we know you are in the business of renewal. So, Lord, hear our prayers and look with favor upon this earth that you have created, for there is much brokenness. And Lord, as we share these moments of brokenness, we will respond by saying, "Oh Lord, listen." For those suffering from the effects of racial tension and the violence that takes place, "Oh Lord, listen." For all those who fear the threat of nuclear attack, but especially those close to North Korea, including its own citizens, "Oh Lord, listen." For those everywhere dealing with natural disasters and the after effects, "Oh Lord, listen." For those who are struggling to make ends meet financially, "Oh Lord, listen." For those who are being hunted down by people who practice genocide, "Oh Lord, listen." For those whose lives are held hostage to addictions and dependencies in whatever forms they may take, "Oh Lord, listen." For those who feel abandoned, either by parent or anyone who has left them, "Oh Lord, listen." Lord, we live in a world where people drive cars into crowds of people. "Oh Lord, listen." We live in a nation where we are so polarized between the labels of conservative, liberal, and Republican Democrat that we can't have a civil conversation about any of the issues. "Oh Lord, listen." We live in a world where millions of people who could be making a real difference in the world are oftentimes spending their time drowned in the entertainment, pleasures, and pastimes of our culture. "Oh Lord, listen." We live in a world where history is marked more by our wars and our atrocities than our achievements. "Oh Lord, listen." Are you listening, Lord? This is your world. You created it. You have sustained it. You continue to redeem people through the work of those who have called into the community of faith known as the church. And so we now ask, Lord, that you would act. Bring healing to the broken places. Renew the heavens and the earth that you might fully reign. O Lord, listen. O Lord, forgive. O Lord, hear and act. For your sake, Lord, do not delay, because your world and your people, they bear your name. And may we place our hope and trust in the knowledge that you are greater than all of this, and that your will be accomplished no matter what. And since you tend to work through your people, may we always be willing to be used by you to be a part of that healing. In Jesus' name we pray, and we all say, Amen.